Hello, my friends, it's the Game Boy Geek here. Today, we're all different raiders, and we're trying to work our way through the jungle, up to the top, and getting into the temple at the top to get the treasure. Today, we're looking at Gold Raiders. This is for 2 to 6 players, takes about 30 minutes to play from quick, simple, fun games. We're gonna be doing a rule school, which I teach you how to set up and play the game so that you don't have to read the rule book. There's an index below me that has the different spots of the rules that you can just click and you can jump to that spot if you're ready to just dive right in. Without further ado, let's get going. Gold Raiders is a 2 to 6 player game where you'll be one of these raiders. And you're trying to advance along the trail and trying to get to the top of this jungle temple where all the treasures are. During the nighttime, players will be playing cards on their stacks or creating new stacks. In the daytime, they have the option to try to move if they've played cards in the right sequences. But watch out, because even one bandit in a pile doesn't make you go forward, it forces you to move backwards regardless of where you would have gone. Play 3 consecutive of the same cards to be able to move 5 forward. Finding the right cards to play in the right piles, knowing when to steal, when to send bandits, when to be able to look at your piles, and when to reveal your specific piles will help you get to the temple and get all the treasure. To set up, first place the board in the middle of the table where everybody can reach it. Next, you'll select a raider, and you'll take that raider and put it on the start space on the board. In the lower left-hand corner of the board, you'll see it says start here, and that's in between the 1 and the minus 1. You put all standees that are playing in that area. You'll shuffle up the main card deck, and you're going to deal 8 cards out to every player face down. Once you get the cards, you can look at them, but keep them secret from everyone else. The rest of the deck will get put off to the side and leave a space next to it for a discard pile. The player that most recently went on a journey takes the first player idle and begins the game. This is a standee that will stand up in front of the player, but this is what it looks like. The object of the game is to journey through the different terrain and be the first player to get to the temple at the end of the day. The game goes through 2 different phases. During the night phase, you'll be playing cards on stacks that already exist or creating new stacks. During the day phase, you'll be flipping them over and resolving cards. There's only 6 different types of cards in the game. 3 of them are moving. They're moving you 1, 2, or 3 spaces or miles throughout the game. And some other cards do some special things we'll talk about later. When you play a card, you'll be playing it face down most of the time. Anything that has this symbol on it means you're either going to put it face down starting a new stack or face down on a stack that already exists. If it has this icon, you'll place it face up in a discard pile and trigger an action. Since this card has both, you can decide whether to put it face down in a pile or a new pile or discard it for its action. In the night phase, starting with the first idle player marker and going clockwise, each player is going to play 1 card. And again, if it's a card that looks like this, you have to put it face down into one of your existing piles or a new one. If it's this, you would put it face up in a discard pile and activate it. So let's say I play a card like this, and then it would go around through all the different players. Let's say it comes back to me, and I decide to add it here. And it's the next player, and it comes back to me, and then I decide to do a new pile. When you pick a new pile, you have to pick it to the right of the pile that's already there. Let's say it comes back to me, and I go like this. So let's say it comes back to me again, and I decide to discard this card and use the ability, which is steal. I can take a stack from any opponent from them, and either add it to the top of one of my stacks, or place it as a new stack. Now, I can never rearrange these in any way. Also, when you play cards, you can never look at your stacks again, or you cannot ever rearrange them unless a card tells you. I can either place that on top of my other stacks like this, or into a new stack. You can never rearrange these. And by the way, when you play cards even on yourself, you can never rearrange them or look at them. There are cards that allow you to look at them, so you can't look at them by default once they're placed. Let's say on my next turn, I play a Recon. This allows me, I could have played this in my pile, which essentially would do nothing, or I can, in this case, put it in the discard pile and do its action. And that allows you to look at any one stack in the game. It could be yours, could be someone else's. So maybe I want to look at the stack I just took, because when you steal, you can't look at that other player's stack. We'll look at this, so we see it is a 1, 1, then a 2. Of course, you have to keep them in the same order. You cannot mix them up or rearrange them in any order. Once everybody has played all eight of their cards, it then goes to the day phase. And beginning with that first player, you can choose to reveal one of your stacks that you want. You don't have to. You don't even have to reveal any right now if you don't want to. But in this case, let's say we reveal this one. Let's say we have mile 1, 2, and 3. The mile 1 is going to allow us to move 1. You can only have one of these in your pile. By default, I'll get to an exception later. The 2 is worth nothing unless it's just directly above a 1. The 3 is absolutely useless unless it's directly above a 2, which is also directly above a 1. So here is a perfect placement. We have a 1 followed by a 2 followed by a 3 consecutively like that. So you'll be able to move each of these miles. A 3 plus 2 plus 1 is 6. So I would have been able to move from the start spot all the way to the 6th mile. Now I just showed you that stack of miles going 1, 2, and 3, and we were able to move 6. Now, the sequence of cards in each stack is relevant, but the orientation of each stack does not matter when resolving in the day phase. Now, if the orientation was flipped, where it went 1, 2, and 3 all next to each other from bottom to top, this would still allow me to move 6 because the sequence is what is most important, the orientation not as important. Before, we were going 1, 2, 3 going top to bottom. Now we're going 1, 2, 3 bottom to top. Whichever orientation gives you the best move for your turn, that's the one you can use. Now let's go through some different possibilities that may have been there. Instead of that 1, 2, 3, let's say we had a recon in the middle. Well, if it's played in your pile, you just simply disregard it. So it does not stop these two from sort of being consecutive one on top of each other, because this definitely gets skipped as you go through here. So this would still allow me to move 6. Now, if my pile looked like this, well, I probably wouldn't have done it on purpose, but maybe I had stolen those cards from somebody else and I didn't know what they were, and I flipped them over. It's a 2 and a 3. Well, the 2 is useless unless it's on a 1, and the 3 is useless unless it's on a 2 and a 1. So this allows me to move 0. Now, here I have two stacks that have the same sequence when looking at the two different orientations. Here I have 1, 3, 2 going top to bottom, and 1, 3, 2 going bottom to top. The sequence is the same, and since that sequence would not allow me to move because of the rules I spoke earlier, neither of these orientations would allow you to move. Now let's say my pile looked like this. I had a 1, 2, and 3, and as we showed by normal, that would have had me move 6. However, there are two bandit cards here. Even if you have just one bandit card, all movement that would have happened is canceled. Not only that, but you would move backwards 2 for each bandit card. So with these two bandit cards, instead of moving forward 6, I actually move back 4, 2 for each of the bandit cards. So if I was at the start spot, I would go all the way back to the minus 4. You can't ever go back further than the minus 5 spot. If you have three cards that are consecutive, one right after another, and that are not a bandit card, that will move you 5. So in this case, we would go 1 because, hey, the 1 just moves us 1, we're good. Then we have 3 recons in a row. This would allow us to move 5 because it's any 3 cards in a row that's not a bandit card, move 5. So a total of 6 we would have just moved. And those pesky bandits, even if there was just one bandit here instead of moving forward 6, of course we would move back 2 as normal. Earlier I mentioned that you can only have one single 1 in your pile, but I mentioned an exception and here it is. You might have 3 consecutive 1s. And when you use these are used as the consecutive ones and not as the normal ones. So this would allow me to move 5 because it's 3 consecutive 1s. This 2 would not allow me to move 2, even though it's on a 1, because these are being used as the consecutive 5 scoring, not the normal 1 scoring. So in this whole pile here, I would move 5 for the consecutive 1s and the 2 wouldn't move us anywhere. Now remember, in that day phase, you're deciding how many you'd like to flip over, reveal, and resolve, but you don't have to even pick any, and you can pick 1, 2, 3, or all of them, or none of them. It's all up to you. Once you're finished, you go to the next player clockwise. You continue this till everyone has gone through the day phase. At the end of the day phase, you see if someone has reached the temple. In this case, nobody has, so we'd start a new round. You'd get all the cards back, shuffle them into the deck, and then deal out 8 cards to each player as if you were starting the game. You then also pass the first player idle marker to the player furthest along the trail. If 2 or more players are tied for being the furthest, give that idle to the player closest in order to the current first player. If at the end of that day phase someone has reached the temple, they win the game. However, if there's a tie, meaning more than one player got to the temple at the end of that day phase, You would then count up the total numbers on all the travel cards in those tied players. Whoever has the most there is the winner. If it's still tied, then it's the player who has the most unrevealed stacks. And if it's still tied, then the player earliest in turn order wins. Well, I hope this helped you dive right into Gold Raiders and get to the fun much faster than you normally would have. If you have further questions about the rules, I've placed the link in the description of this video. You can click there and post it there. That will allow not only myself to see it, but also the publishers where they can help out as well.